You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI show where we learn all about time series forecasting with automated machine learning, a new capability that you can use today. Make sure you check it out. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI show, a special build edition. We're going to talk about time series forecasting with automated machine learning. I've got a special guest with me. Hello, my friend. Tell us who you are and what you do.
Hi, everyone. My name is Sabina Cartasio, and I'm a program manager for Azure Machine Learning, and I focus on forecasting with automated ML.
Fantastic. So let's start with the first and obvious question. What is time series forecasting?
Time series forecasting is the process of using historical data to predict future observations. This is commonly used in industry for tasks such as financial, resource, inventory, and capacity planning.
That's amazing. So what kinds of things do we have to consider when we're doing forecasting? Because I understand that the historical data nature of this, but is there anything else we need to think about?
Yeah, well, when creating a machine learning model in general, we have to consider many different algorithms and hyperparameter values. And when we focus specifically on forecasting, we need to consider seasonality, trends, and even the effects of holidays.
So you're saying that like data that has time series is just different inherently. It sounds like it makes things a little bit more complex, though. How do we train models with these additional considerations?
Definitely. So it is very tricky to consider all of these. But what if instead of manually considering all of these factors, we could actually automate them? So with automated machine learning, we can automate the algorithm selection, the hyperparameter value search, as well as even data featureization, including holidays. And this all comes together to basically help you find the best machine learning model for your data.
So we already had automated machine learning before. Now what we're doing is we're basically making it work with new time series forecasting data. Is that right?
That is correct. Yes.
All right. Who's using this?
We have a few deeply engaged customers, as you can see. Some of these include Wood Group, Schneider Electric, Walmart, G&J Pepsi, and most recently, DriveTime.
All right, so let's see. I'd love to see one of these use cases. Is there a particular customer you'd like to focus on?
Yeah, let's focus on DriveTime. So a little bit of background on DriveTime before we jump in. DriveTime is actually one of the largest used car retailers in the United States. They focus on helping customers find the best vehicle and financing for their needs.
All right, so what are they doing?
Yeah, so they actually are building, using Azure Machine Learning, they're building AML pipelines and leveraging AutoML to basically fuse automated modeling into their proprietary scoring and finance models.
So I'm trying to understand. So what about their data makes it time series based data?
Yeah. So a lot of times, especially in finance, what we're looking at is trends. So we want to know for a financial cycle how maybe things are selling or whether or not customers are returning. And a lot of this is based under seasonality. How do things act over time? And they tend to repeat. That's where we get trends. Around Christmas, you know, toys sell more. It's kind of that pattern that you're looking for with time series.
So basically what they did is they fed their data to automated machine learning and it just generated models. How many models did they generate?
Yeah, so they actually built a multi-step pipeline using AML pipelines to process their different data. And they ended up building over 20,000 different models. This was, not just models, but also featureization techniques and hyperparameter values. And they were able to cherry pick the best model for their use case. Going forward, they're even looking to optimize this whole setup and make it usable for their other high volume data scenarios.
That's really cool. So tell us a little bit more about automated machine learning's forecasting capabilities, because I think this is a new thing.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing that you can see here is deep learning. We actually have a DNN for forecasting specifically that was built in Microsoft Research. We also have models that are popular within the forecasting realm, such as the Riemann Profit. These models are widely popular and they're available within automated machine learning. Alongside this, we also have auto settings and holiday detection.
What do you mean by holiday detection? That's interesting to me.
Yeah, this is definitely a very popular feature. Essentially, you just specify your country or region, and AutoML will go ahead and enrich your data with holiday information.
Oh, and that's interesting to me because it's usually when it comes to seasonality, like holidays are usually when things are just weird and we have to make sure that we account for that kind of weirdness.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. All right. So we've talked a lot about this. I'd love to see some kind of demo. Do you have something you can show us?
Yeah, definitely. So we're actually going to go through an example of orange juice forecasting. So we have a couple stores across the United States that are selling different brands of orange juice, and we want to know how they are selling, so the quantity. And we're going to walk through this notebook. It is a basic automated ML notebook at the skeleton with some forecasting specific variables that we're going to talk about. So the first thing we're going to do is, like with any automated ML experiment, just go ahead and set up. So we're importing the right libraries, making sure that our subscription is set up correctly. And the next important thing is the compute. You're able to use either local or remote compute. Moving forward, we start with arguably the most important part, the data. So here we can see that we're passing in the time column name. The time column name is week starting. We always have to specify what the time is for time series forecasting. And we actually have weekly data. Although if you notice here, we have the same timestamp repeated many times. This is because we have a unique combination of store and brand. So here we can see we have store 2 for Dominick's, Minute Maid, Tropicana, and then you see the same date but for a new store. So that's the trend of our data.
And let's, before we go on, and this is what makes it intrinsically time series based, is that we have a timestamp of sort, but the timestamp is coupled with, in this case, a different store. So that way you have two things going on at the same time.
So this is actually a multi-time series problem. So we are dealing with multiple time series, and AutoML can handle this, and I'm going to show you how we do that.
Awesome.
So right here, to your question, we have a variable called time column names, and this is what we refer to internally as a time series ID. How do you uniquely identify these duplicate timestamps? And we said that this was the combination of store and brand. And we're going to actually go ahead and cut down this problem a little bit, and we're just going to focus on three stores, stores 2, 5, and 8. And we saw from above that there are three brands of orange juice for every store. So it's actually telling us that when we cut down to only three stores, there are 9 individual time series.
I see. Cool. And so basically it's going to do the combination for all of those stores, all of those times.
Exactly.
Love it.
The next part is the data splitting. This is pretty standard for most machine learning, but one thing I want to take note here is these end test periods. What this is referring to is your forecast horizon. So this is how far out into the future you may want to predict. If you notice, we're not passing in a unit. That's because we infer the unit from the data that's passed in. So in our example, we know that we had weekly data. So this 20 means...
I see.
Then we're just going to go ahead and upload the data to the data store. Nothing fancy there. And then create a data set for training. Now, I do want to point out here that we're printing out the tail. So the end of the data, this is extremely important because when you go to predict out or forecast out those 20 units, you know that you have to start from this date point, from the last date in the training data.
Got it.
Now we go into modeling. And again, this is a pretty standard process for all machine learning. You're just passing in the target column, what you want to predict. And in our case, it's quantity, how much orange juice was sold. We also have a small step on customization. This essentially allows you to decide if you want to drop certain columns or change how they're imputed. So if you have a missing value, should we use mean? Should we use past context to fill future context? You can decide all that.
Got it. So standard machine learning featurization stuff.
Exactly.
Got it.
Then we're training. The training is exactly the same as other AutoML. If you notice, the only difference here is we have specific time series settings. So we're setting that time column, that grain, and that horizon that we talked about. And then we're passing it in at the bottom here to AutoML. Once that's done, we go ahead and submit that run. And you can go ahead and track this run in the studio, and I'll show you quickly what that looks like once it's done. So here I can see many different models that were attempted, and I can go ahead and dig into them. I can see graphs and more metrics for each of them. Here we're going to focus on the best model. So we retrieve the best model, which happens to be the standard scalar wrapper, and we can even get transformation and transparency for this model. So we can see all the different transformers. We can see the detected type, whether they were dropped in the pre-processing state or not, and more.
This is cool. So basically, it's just standard once, because the data is the only thing that's different. After that, it's just standard automated machine learning with just an additional 3 settings.
Yes.
That's cool.
And then it becomes a little different when we come at the evaluation portion. Mm-hmm. So when we come to actually gather forecasts,
of course,
because we are actually time aware, right? So that's the next different step. So here we're going to quickly view the test data that we're going to pass in. So if we were to look at the tail from above and this, we'd be able to see that these dates fall within a range of that last date and 20 units forward. And we're not passing in quantity. So we're not passing in that target. So if we go down here, what we're going to do is evaluate. Before we actually ask for predictions, what we want to know, how did this model perform? Let me see some metrics, some of the validation that was done for the model. And you can see how the model performed. So I ran this one for a very short amount of time, but it's still pretty impressive to see such good results. But now I'm more interested in how do I get my forecast? So we're going to operationalize this. When we say operationalize, we mean that we're going to develop a scoring script and we're going to deploy the model. This is going to generate a REST API and we can hit that endpoint to get our forecast. So here we're deploying as an Azure container instance. And then we're going to call the service. So what we see here when we call the service is that we have a new column of data, forecast. And these are actually the predictions returned from the model.
I see. Can we scroll up just because I have a couple of questions here?
Yeah.
So as we scroll up, the one question I had was about the that one right there. So to, if we scroll down, so developing the scoring script, is the scoring script something that developer would have to write? Line 27, I think.
Yeah. So we can actually develop the scoring script for you. But a lot of times when we think about the data scientist persona, this persona might want to go in and actually further develop the scoring script to meet their needs and actually analyze the model compared to other models. However, if you are more in that developer or citizen data scientist role, you don't have to worry about it. This is giving you access to it should you want to do more, but it's all automated.
So it's the best of both worlds because basically, if you just want to use the best model of all the millions of them that you ran, then it just has the scoring script for you that you can just use. But if you're a data scientist and you want to evaluate, okay, I'm going to use this as the starting point for a starter model and then do more research from there, you totally have that option as well.
Exactly. That's exactly
this is,
the point.
This is pretty cool. Where can people go to find out more?
Definitely. So I've actually gone ahead and included two links here. The first one is actually a tutorial for our UI offering, which we kind of saw very quickly on the studio and running you through a forecasting example. Now, if you want to get more in depth, I have a second URL, www.akmsautomlforecast. And this is a very in-depth how-to showing you everything that AutoML does behind the scenes with time series
well,
data.
Well, this has been really amazing. Thank you so much for spending some time with us. Thank you so much for watching. We're learning all about time series forecasting with automated machine learning. Make sure you check it out. See you next time.